I think you'll understand when I say that something. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. Oh, please say to me, you'll let me be your king. And please say to me, you'll let me hold your hand. Now let me hold your hand. Now let me hold your hand.
Thank you for joining us on our journey through the seven deadly sins. Today we come to the sin of lust. And let's be honest, this might not be the most dangerous of all the deadly sins, but this is the one that could definitely lead to the most awkward small group conversation. I can imagine some of you are a little nervous about how we're even going to talk about the sin of lust today. So I think we should just jump right into that one image that, at least for many of us, was so formative. That one image that told us this is what lust is. Bear with me because this is going to be a little PG-13, but it starts with her walking down the street. A beautiful creation of God. Some of you remember what she looked like. She's just minding her own business when all of a sudden the camera scanned away and all of a sudden we saw him. There was something untrustworthy about him, something that just already at first glance made our stomachs turn just a little bit. Maybe it was because he was French. Maybe there was something about that accent. I don't know what it was exactly, but the moment he saw her, the lights went out, the eyes bulged, and immediately he ran to her. He didn't even pause. He didn't even ask her her name. Her name is Penelope, by the way. He didn't bother to introduce himself. Instead, do you remember what he did? He just went, he just smothered her with affection, began to kiss her mwah, 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 over and over again. Yes, Pepe Le Pew was our introduction to the sin of lust. We know what lust looks like. But for the purpose of today, it's not enough to know what lust looks like. What I want to do is to help you understand where lust wants to take you if it is allowed to grow in your life. And to really see that, we go to the story of the book of Esther about King Ahasuerus. The king is the ruler of the Persian Empire. It's at the height of the empire, which literally means he is the most powerful man in the entire world. This king has everything save one thing. He's missing one thing in life, but he can't even name what that one thing is. Thankfully for him, at least in his estimation, he's found a substitute. The thing that gets him through the day, the thing that makes him feel content, is the adulation, the praise of others. So finally what he does, because he's had a number of ways to earn this adulation, finally what he does is he hosts the party to end all parties. He has dignitaries from all 127 provinces he rules over. They come to the palace, as was the custom in those days. The men went with the king. The women went with the queen. The men know what their roles are. They might be the best and the brightest in all of Persia, but they stand before the king. They know what is expected of them. When the king brings out the royal maps of all the countries that he has enslaved, all the countries that he controls, they ooh and ah, and the king feels good. And when he brings out the finest wines, or when he summons the gold to be brought out to demonstrate his lavish amount of wealth, everybody celebrates what the king has done. This is what happens over and over and over again. And every time it does, the king feels really good. He feels content. That hole in his life, it is filled for a moment. But eventually the adulation dies down. You can only ooh and ah over so many maps. You can only be impressed by a certain amount of wealth for so long until eventually it grows boring. Really, really boring. Even these guests know they can't keep this up. After 5 or 6 days, they're ready to just go home. But the king needs more. Until finally, in that fit of desperation, he remembers he still has one thing. One thing that will impress the people. And so he summons for Vashti. Vashti is the most beautiful object in his entire kingdom. Surely that will impress these people who have grown bored. The problem is that Vashti is not a crown. Vashti is not made of gold. Vashti is not an amazing piece of artwork. Vashti is a person. Vashti is the queen. Vashti is his wife. He summons her to come to the party, to parade around in front of the men, to be wearing the crown and her royal jewels. As if that doesn't sound awful enough, feminist scholars, at least some feminist scholars, argue, I think rather convincingly, that is what is implied in the king's command, is that Vashti would show up wearing only a crown and only the royal jewels as she parades around in front of the male guests. Friends, that's the power of lust. It is when we begin to see other people as objects. That's the destination. Lust doesn't settle for that momentary attraction where you see someone and all of a sudden there's an extra beat in your heart when you're 16 or 17 years old. No, that's a natural reaction. What lust wants to do is to prey upon those moments and grow from there until eventually you get to the point in life where it's that flirty remark at work, or it's the neighbor who stops by to tell you how great your new vehicle looks. It is treating other people like objects. It is using them for the adulation, for the praise, for the feelings that they give you. That's the real power of lust. And what lust does is that it blinds us. It blinds us to others, that we no longer see others as people, but we see them as objects. And even more destructive in our own lives is that once lust has done that, lust blinds us not only to people, lust blinds us to what it is that we're truly missing in life. Again, we see this in the story of Queen Vashti and King Ahasuerus. He summons for her. Thankfully, Queen Vashti says no. The king's a moron. He doesn't know what to do with us. Nobody in the Persian Empire has ever said no to him before. He immediately summons his advisors. They don't know what to do with this either. So finally, one of them suggests sending Vashti away, as if that's punishment. Sending her away, it's not punishment. She's free. She's emancipated from this. She no longer has to be treated like an object. But Ahasuerus, the king, he remains blind for the rest of the story, blind to the people around him, serving anything more, being anything more to him than objects, and especially blind to what it is that he's really missing in life. You know what he's really missing? He might have everything in the world, but the one thing he desires more than anything is to be known and loved. And unfortunately, because of the power of lust, the one person who is capable of knowing him, the one person who is capable of loving him, is sent away. That's what lust wants to do. People of God, if you want to be free from lust, you can be. All you have to do is open your eyes. All you have to do is open your eyes, not just to see that other people around you are truly people, not objects to be used, but open your eyes to what that great need that all of us have. It is to be known and loved. If you open your eyes, you will discover that it's already happened. It's already yours. The one who created the heavens and the earth knows you completely, the good and the bad. And this one has said in the person of Jesus Christ, you are mine, you are loved, you are forgiven, and you are mine. People of God, we already have what it is that we are looking for in life, which means that we don't have to see other people as objects. We don't have to go through life blind to what it is that we're missing in life because we already have it. So we invite you now to turn to one another and have a conversation about the ways in which it is easy in life to objectify people, to look for others to fulfill those unmet needs in our own lives. And most of all, look for and talk about the places in your life where you have experienced that unconditional love of God and Jesus Christ. Again, thanks for joining us. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. Oh, please say to me, you'll let me be your man. And please say to me, you'll let me hold your hand.
Now let me hold your hand. Now let me hold your hand.